Aaron, go ahead and queue up, or Karen, queue up the video that I'm going to show. I have a music video to show you in just a second. But before we do, let's all open our Bibles one more time together this summer to the book of Zechariah. We have spent our Sundays together this summer working through significant portions of the book of Zechariah, and we've called this series Courage, Dear Heart. Because that was essentially Zechariah's message to the newly released Jewish exiles who had been tasked with rebuilding the broken down, burned up, destroyed temple. Rebuilding efforts are never easy. If you have ever tried to rebuild a relationship or a family or your health or a church or a life, you know that during those times of rebuilding, you need a Zechariah whispering courage into your soul. And that was his ministry. He was constantly encouraging the people, hey, you can do this. I know rebuilding is tough, but you can do it. Your failures have not disqualified you. God's grace is still sufficient for you. In fact, God's grace is so powerful, it can give you hinds feet, the feet of a deer or a mountain goat that can just scamper up the treacherous heights. I want to be a modern day Zechariah. I want our church to be a Zechariah church. If someone bumps up against the well of our life, I want encouragement to splash all over them and get in their eyes. If someone hangs around our church for a while, I want courage to start squishing between their toes when they walk. And today, to close out this series, I want to start by having you watch a music video. This is scenes from the Son of God movie set up against David Crowder's song, I Am Holding On to You. And I may have shown this to you before, I can't recall, but I'm going to give up 4 precious minutes of our 1 hour service that we get here in the mornings at Calvary. And I want to have you watch this video because the very last scene will be the introduction to what I want us to talk about as we say goodnight to Zechariah. So look up at the screens and we'll watch this video.
There's no space that his love can't reach. There's no place where we can't find peace. There's no end to amazing grace. Take me in with your arms spread wide. Take me in like an orphan child. Never let go, never leave my side. I am holding on to you. I am holding on to you. In the middle of the storm, I am holding on, I am. Love like this, oh my God. This is my resurrection song. This is my hallelujah come. This is why it's to you I run.
final scene of that video, when Jesus is greeting the Apostle John on the island of Patmos, and you can still see the hole in his hand where the crucifixion nails pierced them and punctured them and broke a hole in them, that's the picture that I want to use to end the Zechariah series today. And I want to talk to you today on the subject of scars. Because in the kingdom of God, in the Jesus-shaped life, scars are our superpower. So in Zechariah chapter 12, we read a messianic prophecy. And a messianic prophecy, of course, is a word that was spoken hundreds of years before the time of the Messiah, Jesus, and yet those words pointed to and were fulfilled by Jesus. And we've read several of those in the book of Zechariah. His book is packed with those. But in Zechariah 12, verse 10, we read another one of those messianic prophecies, and here's what we read. It says, "And I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and supplication. They will look on me, the one they have pierced, and they will mourn for him as one mourns for an only child, and grieve bitterly for him as one grieves for a firstborn son." Do you recognize those words? You've probably read those words before. You've probably read them more often in John's gospel. In the gospel of John, when John sees all of the details surrounding the crucifixion of Jesus, he says this in John 19:36, "These things happened so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And as another scripture says, they will look on the one they have pierced." See, John saw what was happening at the crucifixion, and he realized, wow, Zechariah was talking about this moment. At the moment of the crucifixion, Rome was indifferent to Jesus. The Jewish religious leaders were celebrating and triumphing in his crucifixion, but there were other people present as well. There were followers, and there were believers, and they looked upon the one who had been pierced, and they were mourning the way a person mourns for an only child. Drop down just a couple of verses. In chapter 13, verse 1, it says, "On that day, the day of the Lord's piercing, on that day a fountain will be opened to the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to cleanse them from sin and impurity." One more time. "On that day, a fountain will be opened to the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to cleanse them from sin and impurity." Wow. When Jesus was pierced, a fountain was opened. When Jesus was broken open, a fountain was released for the world. And there are numerous places where the Bible tells us that the fountain of the blood of Jesus contains curative properties. The blood of Jesus is able to remove the stain and the trauma of sin. The blood of Jesus is able to cleanse a guilty conscience. The blood of Jesus is able to sprinkle and restore nations. Listen to Hebrews 10, verse 19. It says, "Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain," that is his body. The way was opened through the piercing of his body. "And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water." The piercing, or the opening of Jesus' body that released this fountain, contains the power to heal the world from the rupture and the damage of sin. It's breathtaking that when Jesus was pierced, a fountain was opened. We just finished reading The Genius of Jesus. Hopefully you finished that book. That was our summer reading project this year. In the last chapter of the book, Erwin McManus talked about how utterly genius it is that Jesus was able to take death and pull life out of it. If we really consider that, it's absolutely staggering to think that the most recognizable symbol today anywhere in the world is the cross. And it is not recognized as a Roman death instrument. It's recognized as the life that God pulled out of death. It's amazing. But it's also amazing to consider that in light of all of that epicness, Jesus' body still bears scars. In John chapter 20, verse 19, it says, "On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, and the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord." Verse 24 says, "Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, or the twin, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, 'Hey, we've seen the Lord.' But he said to them, 'Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were, unless I put my hand to his side, I will not believe.' A week later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Through locked doors, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you.' Then he said to Thomas, 'Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it to my side. Stop doubting and believe.'" This is so fascinating to me. In this post-resurrection moment, Jesus Christ had a reconstructed body. When Jesus was raised from the dead, he had a body that was a preview of what the Bible promises. And this body is so fascinating. When you look at the post-resurrection appearances of Jesus, it is so interesting because the things we see about Jesus' body confirm some of the things that are being discovered in deep realms of physics today. Jesus had a reconstituted body that was able to move through a locked door. He didn't do that because he was God. He did that because he had a different kind of body. He appeared like a ghost, but he was able to eat breakfast with them. He appeared, and then he would disappear, and then he would reappear over here, just like they're discovering in string theory and different aspects of physics. It's so fascinating. Jesus is confirming what we're discovering today. But think about this. He had a new body, healed from the cross, perfect in every way, exactly what God was originally intending, and yet it still bore scars. I wonder if any angels or departed saints ever questioned that. Hold on a second. You're perfect. Why would you still have a scarred part of your body? If anyone had ever asked him about that, why would you want to carry scars in this newly perfected body of yours? I imagine he might say, "Well, I've looked into the future a few days. And I know that when I appear to my remaining 11 disciples, Thomas is not going to be with them. And I know Thomas. And I know that when they tell him, 'We've seen the Lord,' he is going to say, 'You are out of your minds.' Thomas is the kind of guy, he's going to say, 'Unless I can touch the scar, unless I can see where the spear tore open the fountain in his body.'" We remember that a Roman spear pierced his side and a fountain of water and blood was poured out. "Unless I see those things, I'm not going to believe it." I could just hear Jesus. Don't you just love him? Even watching that video, are you just melted? I could just hear Jesus saying, "I will carry scars for all of eternity if it helps Thomas believe." Do you have any scars on your body? Most people have a scar. Should we have a Donald Rucker moment? Should we all turn to our neighbor and show them our worst scars? Well, we all have scars, don't we? I think my first scar came when I was 5. It was at my brother's birthday party. I stepped on a chunk of glass in the river, and it required several scars. I got another scar I think I was in junior high, and I was kind of pouty and being a baby. I had been on a school trip, and I was gone for a few days. When I came back, they told me to clean out the van before I could see my family. So I got all mad, and I slammed the van door right into my thigh. It tore it open. I actually could see the muscle in my leg, and I still have scars from that. But most everybody has a scar on their body, and we get scars for several reasons, don't we? I'll just list them for you. Number one, sometimes our scars tell us that we're stupid. See, sometimes we did crazy things that we didn't need to do, and they were reckless, and they caused us to injure ourselves. Some of our scars are unnecessary. But you know what? Number two, sometimes our scars don't tell us that we're stupid. They tell us that we're alive. They tell us that, I wasn't reckless. I was just playing hard. I actually got out of the lazy boy once in a while in my life and tried to do something. A few years ago, Donald Miller wrote a book called 1,000 Miles in a Million Years. And the subtitle is How I Learned to Live a Better Story. And in this book, he tells the story of when he was writing in a coffee shop. So he was sitting in the corner of a coffee shop typing, working on a book. And this young couple came in with kind of a fussy baby. And their little baby was kind of crying and kind of whiny and kind of irritating. And they weren't quieting him. And he saw this couple with this baby, and he started getting annoyed. And then he did the whole sigh. And then after, when the sigh didn't work, he did the glare. Like, can't you shut that baby up? And as his agitation was rising, he had an epiphany. And he realized, I've been sitting in the corner of a coffee shop for years, writing books about how to live. And while I've been writing about how to live a great life, this guy actually mustered up the courage to ask that girl out on a date. And after she said yes, somehow he convinced her to go out again. And while I've been sitting here writing theory about these things, they actually started a life. And they've actually begun living. Sometimes our scars are proof that we've lived. And number three, sometimes our scars tell us that we're survivors. You know, I might not love that giant scar from that one surgery, but that scar is proof that I made it. Wait. You survived Roman crucifixion and death and burial. Yeah, let me show you. Our scars are proof. You ever see the original Jaws? All of us old people, remember the scar scene? Oh yeah, well what about this? Oh yeah, well what about... Our scars are proof that we survived. And how about the scars that aren't on the outside of your body? How about your inside scars? Because if we could see deep into your soul today, it's quite possible that there would be scars of betrayal or heartbreak or regret. See, most of us don't like our physical scars. If you've been disfigured by a scar, or if you have a long scar across your abdomen or around one of your joints, you don't usually love it. And why is that? Or maybe you do love it. We think they're ugly. Nobody likes their outside scars. We think they're ugly. Merriam-Webster says a scar is a mark that's left behind after damaged tissue heals. But the downside of a scar is that the mark is not like the sweet, fresh skin of a baby. It's a forever sign that we have been damaged. And we'll never be quite the same again. But by the way, just in case you do have a really traumatic scar somewhere on your body, I want to remind you, it never looks as bad to the rest of us as it does to you. I promise you that. But I think that people are just as self-conscious of their inside scars as they are of their outside scars. Sometimes people wear one-piece bathing suits or long sleeves because they don't want anyone to see a scar that they went through. Sometimes other people wear guardedness or defensive postures because they're trying to cover up an inside scar. See, if we have a scar on the outside, it usually means that something happened to us, and that's not really our fault. But when we have an inside scar, we're more vulnerable to feelings of failure. See, nobody judges someone when they have a scar from an appendicitis. Idiot! How in the world could you let your appendix rupture like that? No, but if it's a scar from divorce, wonder what happened. I wonder whose fault it was. See, scars are pretty vulnerable, aren't they? Do you think it was risky for Jesus to show up with scars on his perfectly reconstituted body? Wait, you can defeat death, but you're still marred? I think Jesus has a different perspective on scars. See, in the kingdom of God, in the Jesus-shaped life, our scars are three things. Number one, our scars are messages. And number two, our scars are ministries. And number three, our scars are credentials. We've already talked about some of the messages that our scars send. They've said that we've lived. They've said that we've survived. But they also tell us this. Scars tell us that we've learned. Drop down just a couple more verses in Zechariah 12. Actually, Zechariah 13, verse 2. It says, "On that day, I will banish the names of the idols from the land, and they will be remembered no more," declares the Lord Almighty. "I will remove both the prophets and the spirit of impurity from the land." So he's talking about false prophets who were deceptive and ran counter to God's purpose and truth. "If anyone still prophesies, their father and mother to whom they were born will say to them, 'You must die because you've told lies in the Lord's name.'" That's quite a level of zeal for a parent to say that. "Then their own parents will stab the one who prophesies." Now, not a death blow, just a flesh wound. "On that day, every prophet will be ashamed of their prophetic vision. They will not put on a prophet's garment of hair in order to deceive. Each will say, 'I'm not a prophet. I'm a farmer. The land has been my livelihood since my youth.' And if someone asks, 'Well, what are these wounds on your body?' they will answer, 'The wounds I was given at the house of my friends.'" Have you ever had a friend wound you appropriately? We've all had the inappropriate wounding. Has a friend ever wounded you for the right reasons? In Psalm 141:5, King David says this. He says, "Let a righteous man strike me." That's a kindness. "Let him rebuke me." In fact, that's oil on my head, and my head will not refuse it. See, sometimes our scars say that we've learned. I will never prophesy falsely again. I will never be on the wrong side again. I've paid a price. This is a hard-won lesson, and I've got the scars to prove it. But whether we get our scars because of something we learned or something that happened to us, number three, our scars are our credentials. Wherever you carry a scar, you have something to teach. I wish there were a less painful way of getting a teaching credential. But wouldn't you rather be taught by someone who's actually lived the message that they're presenting? Your scars are your credentials. In fact, on the soul level, your scars are the letters behind your name. Jessica's going to get a couple more letters behind her name soon. She has always wanted to be a nurse. When we first got married, that was her dream. But then we had our first daughter, Alexis, who had massive health problems, died when she was 3. In fact, this coming weekend is the anniversary of when she died. And so Jessica's life went a different direction. She has an associate's degree in theology and then went back to school years later to chase nursing. She got her regular associate's degree, but busy kids, life was never able to happen. Well, she's back in school. She just finished her junior year. So I am now married to a college senior. I told her the other day, I said, "It's been a long time since I made out with a college senior. So what are you doing later?" But on the soul level, the scars that you carry are the letters behind your name. They're your credentials. They're survival badges. And then here's the point of the message right here. Since Jesus calls us to follow in his steps, your scars, and here's the superpower right here. Your scars are tributaries of the larger fountain that was opened in his body. When Jesus was pierced, a fountain was opened. What's a tributary? A tributary is an offshoot of a larger river. And in the kingdom of God, that there's something about Christianity that's absolutely amazing. If you wound a Christian badly enough, they'll probably start a ministry. If you crush a Christian enough, they'll probably file to start a nonprofit organization to help other people who have been crushed in the exact same way. It's the most unbelievable thing. It's kind of like Obi-Wan Kenobi in the original Star Wars. Strike me down, please, because I'll come back stronger. That's the superpower of the kingdom of God. I was pierced, and now a fountain has begun to pour. That was Job's story. Oh my gosh, Job has been dead for thousands and thousands of years, and millions of people are still getting healed by him. God wasn't unfairly crushing Job. He was dangling Job. He was declaring war, saying, Satan, do you want to open a fountain that will be healing people for thousands and thousands and thousands of years? I do need to say real quickly, though, that our wounds have to be clean. Both of these statements are true at the same time. Wounded people wound people, and healed people heal people. The best healers are wounded healers, but to be a wounded healer, your wounds have to be clean. And so we have to make sure that our wounds are clean. And listen, if we're going to be a church that builds on our foundations of grace and tries to offer hope to the world, we are going to have to be very comfortable with scars. We're going to have to be a safe place, because this superpower, it's hidden under a mark that a lot of people don't want to talk about. A lot of people would rather keep covered up with clothing or posturing or any number of things. We're going to have a lot of faith that God is still in the business of rescuing and healing lives. And listen, that is what we're called to in this era of ministry. Let me have the worship team come back up. Listen, to wrap this series up, I'll just finish the story. The people that Zechariah was encouraging were pretty scarred. They had been scarred by the loss of homeland, the loss of national identity, the loss of evident protection from God, the mistreatment of a 70-year exile in Babylon, the promised people, the chosen people that Abraham left his homeland to form, have lost it all, and then they spent a generation in Babylon, their enemy. They were scarred pretty badly. But the amazing thing about the book of Zechariah is Zechariah was one of the few successful prophets. They finished the temple. They actually got the work done. Despite the scarring, despite the trauma, despite the opposition, the temple was rebuilt. And then Nehemiah came along a few years later and he put walls around the temple to protect it. Zechariah had a job well done. People inhaled the courage. They inhaled the encouragement. They went to work despite the scarring, and God did incredible things. And the Lord will do that in your life and in our church, and in the lives of lots and lots of people through what he does.